So, what the preacher forgot to say, we're back in Mark's Gospel. I'm calling this series Deep and Wide. It's about how to be a disciple of Jesus. That's one of the reasons that Mark writes the Gospel, helps us know how to be a follower. We looked at the first five chapters, Jesus kind of coming on the scene, showing who he is, gathering followers. This is the middle bit, and it's where the opposition really takes hold. Will his followers carry on following, or will they fall by the wayside? Will Jesus carry on with his mission, or is it just too hard and too depressing for him? Will he step back? So we're looking at what it means to press in, to go really deep, and as you're going wide, to cope with the opposition and the difficulty and the challenge. What happens in this chapter and other chapters is we see that Jesus is brilliant and people love it, but then they turn on him really quickly. They want him, but they don't want him. He's attractive, but also he's repulsive. And I don't mean stinky, smelly, repulsive. I mean, he repels. Something about his message, his holiness, is really good, but people can't cope with it. So he comes to Nazareth, beginning of chapter 6, hometown. They're going, this is amazing, all these miracles, all this authority. And then they go, hey, hang on a moment, he's one of us. That's ridiculous. They start scoffing him. He says to his disciples, you're going to go into towns, they're going to love you, but then they're going to hate you. So be careful, be ready to walk away. Right at the end of the chapter, he sees his disciples that are in trouble. He wants to pass them by, he wants to reveal himself to them. It's a particular word about a revelation. It's almost like going from the natural to the supernatural. It's when God says to Moses, I want to pass you by. I want to show you who I am. It's a beautiful word, and Jesus intends to reveal himself to his disciples. So he's going to go and do it. They just get really scared and frightened, think he's a ghost. And oh no, it doesn't work out. They don't want him. They're too scared. He says, hey, hang on. He wants to give himself. He wants to show himself, but people cannot cope and they react in all kinds of different ways. So we'll look at that. In the middle of this chapter, we've got this story that just kind of comes in, which is about John the Baptist, and that is Jesus' cousin. Jesus has sent his disciples away, and that kind of time, Herod, the king, hears about Jesus and thinks it's John the Baptist to come back to life. So that must mean John the Baptist has died. And then we get the story of John the Baptist's death. Jesus is obviously hearing the news. And so when his disciples come back, he says, let's go away to a quiet place. He's obviously just devastated, moved. It's just awful. You get that sense of sadness with this story being written in the middle here. But again, there's an idea in the story of attraction and repelling, and what happens when holiness walks into the room. So the story of John the Baptist is he's been arrested and put in prison by Herod because he's challenging and he's criticizing. And he's particularly personally criticized Herod and Herod's wife Herodias, because Herod's wife was Philip's wife, Herod's brother, and is now there. These two have shacked up together. And John says, that's not right. The way you're living is not right. Herodias is really angry, wants him dead. Herod is angry and hurt, but also kind of intrigued. It says here in verse 20, for Herod was afraid of John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he kept him safe. That's interesting, isn't it? There's something about righteousness, holiness. There's a respect. You go, wow, that's, I love that. It's beyond me. And there's something about it that's very, very attractive. There is, because you go, that's the way of living, that is right. And most human beings, when they see holiness and see righteousness, it's like, yeah, that's right, I'm challenged, but I kind of want that for myself. Now, at the same time, most human beings, when they see holiness and righteousness, also go, I hate that, because it's too provocative, it's asking too much of me, it's making me look bad, or I feel ashamed, or I can't live up to that, or it's criticizing me, this holiness, and so we're repelled. The Spirit of Jesus attracts people and repels people. That's what we see in chapter 6, and we'll see it in the next few chapters as well. His holiness is beautiful. It's amazing. It brings miracles and healing, but at the same time, it puts its finger on people's lives, and they can't cope. I'm like that. Holiness walks into the room. I love it, and I hate it. I want it and I don't want it. Same with Herod. He's afraid of John because there's something about this righteousness that is big and glorious. And then it says, and when he heard him, he was very perplexed, but he used to enjoy listening to him. The word perplexed means a loss. It's like there's a loss, an emptiness, there's a vacuum, I'm hearing him and it's revealing something. Perplexed. I don't quite get it. I want to get it. I feel lost somehow. He's feeling lost when he hears him, but he used to enjoy listening to him, so he likes it. He likes feeling lost. He doesn't like feeling lost, but it's the same thing. It's kind of, I love this stuff, but it makes me feel bad and it makes me feel like there's a vacuum. Well, that is the anointing of the Holy Spirit on John the Baptist, on Jesus. Can be on you and me, certainly when it comes close to us. Oh my goodness, it's revealing something. I want it, but I hate it. Then what happens is how does he swing? Is he going to carry on defending John, or is he going to give in to his wife and others? Anyway, his wife's daughter dances at a feast. She's obviously very pretty. You kind of get the impression it says there's a Lord's military commanders leading men of Galilee. There's a lot of blokes there. There's a pretty young girl dancing. I don't know how she's dancing. Maybe it's attractive. Maybe it's sexual. I don't know. Maybe they're drunk and whatever. But anyway, he's really proud of all this and he just wants to look great in front of them. He says, oh, whatever you want. She goes to her mum and what shall I ask for? The mum says, the head of John the Baptist. He's sworn, I'll give you anything you want, because he wants to look good. He's more about himself. Immediately she came to the king and said, I want you to give me the head of John the Baptist. And although the king was very sorry, so he was sorry, yet because of his oaths and because of his dinner guests, he was unwilling to refuse her. Again, you got this thing. He's sorry, but there's something else that takes over. I'm just too stubborn. I can't. I've got to do what you want me to do. That is, again, it's what holiness does to you. It confronts us and reveals what's going on in our heart. Will I go soft-hearted or will I go hard-hearted? That's what the middle chapters of Mark are all about. Hard-heartedness, soft-heartedness, fear, or welcome, anger or amazement, love or hate, and the holiness of John. Then there's this challenge, and Herod goes, can't do it. And so brought his head on a platter, gave it to the girl. The girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about this, they came and took away his body, laid it in a tomb. Quite challenging stuff. What's going on in your heart? I know that we love Jesus, we love the Word of God, we love the fullness of the Spirit, we love worship. But also, the light shines on us and it's awkward, it's like we're ashamed, you know, Adam and Eve, chapter 3 of Genesis, God's looking for them. Oh, I don't want to be seen by him, his holiness, his righteousness, it's too embarrassing for me. We were afraid, we hid, the hiding away. The God who wants to reveal, which is the opposite of the hiding, revelation or hiddenness. So much of the Bible is about this. So think about it. What's the Holy Spirit saying to you? Where are you up to with all this? Have a think, consider. God bless.